Hello again, and welcome to lecture number four. Today's topic will be public relations research. So basically, every public relations program or solution should probably begin with research. The various approaches to how you solve problems with public relations all start with some kind of research. Instinct, intuition, gut feelings all remain an important part of the conduct of public relations work, but management today demands more. They want measurement, analysis, and evaluation at pretty much every stage of the public relations process. They want to know if it's working. In an area of scarce resources, management wants facts and statistics from PR professionals to show that their efforts all contribute not only to an organizational effectiveness, but also to the bottom line. Why should we introduce a new intranet publication or a web page? What should our publication or flyer say? How much should it cost? How do we reach out to the media? How do we know they published something? How do we know if it's working, basically? So questions must be answered through research. So basically what we're saying is businesses and industries don't want to spend money unless it really enhances results. So public relations campaigns must be able to contribute to meeting business objectives. That means basically research must be applied to help segment market audiences, analyze what an audience preference is, what they like, what they don't like, and determine which messages might be most effective with various audiences. Research then becomes basically an essentially helping realize management's goals. Research should be applied in public relations work, both in the initial stage, prior to planning a campaign, and in the final stage to evaluate whether the program is effective or not. Basically, early research will help determine the current situation, what are the attitudes people have, and the difficulties that the program faces. And later research will examine the program's success, along with what else still needs to be done. Research at both ends is extremely important and critical in the whole process. So basically what you're going to try to do is put together a public relations plan. The planning process involves everything you need to know about who your subject is and who your audience is. The first step is to identify the issue, your direction, and the audiences or publics that you wish to address. So what you're basically trying to find out is what you need to do. What's your problem that needs to be solved? Figure out who the audience is that you need to reach out to, and start putting together your plan on how to get that done. Once you know what your problem is or what you need to have solved, you need to figure out who you're trying to develop a PR campaign to. I remember when I was at first started at LCC, we used to send out copies of our schedule to pretty much every person in Luzerne County, which means every person in the county got a copy of our giant catalog of schedule of classes. Did that make sense? Did I reach all the audiences? A lot of times we would get phone calls from people saying, please take me off the list. I'm 80 years old. I don't want to take a class, or we don't have any children, or, you know, there's a million reasons why they didn't want the schedule at all. And nowadays we look for the figure out who our audience is that we need to reach out to. So who are we looking for? Young adult women, single parents, college kids, children, different ethnicities, elderly people, moms, business or industry, religious folks, the Midwest, farmers, truckers, pretty much anybody. We have to define who it is that we need to reach out to and try to create our message to make sure we're saying the right thing to the right people, that our message is getting heard and by the people that we need to reach to be able to accomplish our goals. So when we're trying to put together a public relations campaign, And we're trying to define our audience, who we're writing or planning to reach. We need to ask or answer these questions, like who exactly should we reach with the message? Who's our target audience that's going to make a difference? What can that audience help to achieve the organization's objectives? So if I'm trying to reach a particular person or group of people, how would they actually get us to solve the problem? What are the characteristics of that audience? Who are they? What do they like to do? Where do they shop? What are their habits? What are they interested in? Do they have a certain amount of money that would help us? Do they have an altruistic type of a background that they would try to help people in some capacity? Do they believe in causes? What is the demographic information that can be used to structure the message? So based on maybe their age, where they live, their income level, we might craft our message and campaign based on those statistics. What is it that the audience needs to know or wants to know? And how can the message be tailored to that audience's self-interest? How do we show that what we're trying to do will benefit that person? So what are some ways that public relations professionals can benefit from research? One, it achieves accountability with management. So basically, when management's asking what I do all day, I can show them what I do by showing them the research. Well, we did this with our plan, and these are the results we got from it. And that makes our bosses happy. We can define who our audience is, who our public is. So basically by researching or doing research, we could find out who our audience is, who buys our products, who gives us money for something, who shows up at our shows, who watches our movies. Basically by trying to figure out who that audience is, we can define that audience. It'll help us put together a strategy. So when we're creating the plan, we'll have an idea of what to do based on the research and what we've learned about that audience or our product or what we're trying to achieve. We could put our plan together using the information we've garnered. We can test messages. So if I create a slogan for something, I can test it out on an audience and see what they think. And this happens a lot with movies, books, events that are going on where numerous movies have been changed based on what they've shown to a test audience. Endings of movies have been completely redone and shot based on what the audience felt after they saw it. It also helps keep management in touch. So basically, again, I think I mentioned this earlier, management sometimes is dealing with management. They deal with people on their level. They're not seeing things down on the ground level. They're not hearing from their publics. They're not talking to the frontline people. So having research shows us exactly, or shows them, what's happening out there, how their product is affecting people, what people are saying about it. It can prevent a crisis. By using research, you can identify problems that you already have or that can lead to a major issue. You can have a survey come back and tell you that people are feeling uncomfortable with a product or a service that's out there. And this is a time where we can take that information and then make something happen or change something to prevent a crisis from happening down the road. We can monitor the competition. So a lot of times I will use research to find out what other colleges or universities are saying or doing. We'll look at their websites. We'll look at what messages they're putting out there. So we can monitor the competition by using research. Again, using that information that we garner from surveys or reaching out to audiences, we can use that information to help influence public opinion. So if we need to change something or change a message or a thought process or feeling, we can use the information that we've gathered by interviewing people that our companies have gathered information about that particular audience. We can then use it to help change a public opinion. Again, a lot of times we'll use research just to generate publicity. And in the links below, you'll see a number of different news stories that resulted from surveys and research. And we can use this to measure our success. Did our plan work? Did our PR campaign generate the results that we wanted? We can measure the success, whether it worked or didn't work, and how we can even make it better.
In order to understand market research and PR, we need to define the term. The American Marketing Association has a great definition. It's the function that links the consumer to the marketer through information. In order to have a strategy that gets marketing penetration and sales volume, you need to know what the mindset is of your target consumers. PR is all about changing minds, so it behooves us to find out what the mindset is of your consumers and clients before we start a PR campaign. We find out things like what they think of your industry, what their opinion is of your company if they know about you, your products, your services, what do they need and want, what do they hate, what do they like, what do they dislike, how your marketing messages should reach them, what they'd be more receptive to listen to or actually read rather than just toss or throw away. These are just some of the things that we can find out in our marketing research. Bad experiences, tainted viewpoints, bad publicity about a product or a certain company or a type of company can all cause difficulties for you unless you have the marketing intelligence to be able to push through those emotional barriers. If you don't have that, it'll cost you a lot of time and a lot of money to figure it out, and you may never get there. The reason why we get such good results in public relations is because we know what the media wants. Not only do we do our own market research on the media, but we do it on the target markets of our clients. And when we present stories to the media, we're talking about their target markets that they know. They know that we understand the buttons and the barriers and what people want to hear about or read or In order to understand market research and PR, we need to define the term. The American Marketing Association has a great definition. It's the function that links the consumer to the marketer through information. In order to have a strategy that gets marketing penetration and sales volume, you need to know what the mindset is of your target consumers. PR is all about changing minds. So it behooves us to find out what the mindset is of your consumers and clients before we start a PR campaign. We find out things like what they think of your industry, what their opinion is of your company if they know about you, your products, your services, what do they need and want, what do they hate, what do they like, what do they dislike, how your marketing messages should reach them, what they'd be more receptive to listen to or actually read rather than just toss or throw away. These are just some of the things that we can find out in our marketing research. Past bad experiences, tainted viewpoints, bad publicity about a product or a certain company or a type of company can all cause difficulties for you unless you have the marketing intelligence to be able to push through those emotional barriers. If you don't have that, it'll cost you a lot of time and a lot of money figure it out, and you may never get there. The reason why we get such good results in public relations is because we know what the media wants. Not only do we do our own market research on the media, but we do it on the target markets of our clients. And when we present stories to the media, we're talking about their target markets that they know. They know that we understand the buttons and the barriers and what people want to hear about or read or listen to.
So that video that you just watched gave you a good idea of why research is important and how it's used to benefit the company, business, industry that requires PR. Here's an example of really bad public relations. Would you put out a product if you really didn't know what the name of the product meant? Reebok, a number of years ago, put out a women's shoe and called it the Incubus. So basically, Reebok tripped over their laces with this one, as it says in the article. The shoe company had to backpedal like crazy. In 1997, after news reports revealed that their name for a woman's running shoe, the Incubus, had a distinctly unpleasant meaning. From the dictionary, Incubus is an evil spirit believed to descend upon and have sex with women while they sleep. Said a Reebok spokesperson, "I'm horrified and the company's horrified. How the name got on the shoe and went forward, I do not know." Well, the in-house marketers came up with the name. Basically, returnees screened it to make sure nobody else was using someone else's trademark, but nobody bothered to look up the word in a dictionary. So the moral of the story is simple. Unless you're absolutely positively sure you know what this unusual word means, look it up. Always look it up and check. And this is where testing a name or a message like that would have been important and probably would have saved them a lot of money. They basically had to take the shoes off the shelf, repackage them basically under a new name to try to sell them again. But it was a very poor, expensive mistake. Now, last week in our history lecture, we talked about the publicity stunt. And that was part of your assignment for this week, was to come up with a publicity stunt that happened sometime in throughout history or up till now. And basically the idea behind a publicity stunt is something done to attract attention to your company, your business, your service, or whatever, using something that's a bit unusual or awe-inspiring that would attract the crowd and potentially the media. Here's an example of something that started out as sounded like a fun idea that would attract a lot of attention, definitely the media, but didn't always turn out to be what they'd hoped.
According to all accounts, William G. Crush, a passenger agent for the Katy Railroad, was just trying to figure out what to do with some of the line's obsolete 30-ton steam locomotives. Some had already been sold to logging operations. Others had been sent to gravel pits. Still, there were plenty left that would just have to be scrapped. In the 19th century, the railroad accident was perhaps the most spectacular disaster that could occur. It seemed a day didn't go by without the newspapers reporting on a deadly rail mishap. It occurred to Crush that the Katy could capitalize on the public's grotesque fascination of this by staging a head-on collision using two of the old locomotives. The Katy could sell train tickets to the event and make a fortune. The locomotive's boilers contained high-pressure steam, however. If they ruptured during impact, they would go off like twin bombs, making the event too dangerous to stage. The men that built the engines, however, assured Crush this wouldn't happen. On the chosen day, special trains crammed with people headed to the event at a location dubbed Crush, Texas. A midway had appeared, and politicians decided it was a good place to give speeches. At 5 p.m., Crush, mounted on a white steed, waved his hat, and the engines were released. The crews opened up the throttles, then jumped off. The trains raced toward each other, and by the time they closed the 1 mile distance between them, they had a combined speed of over 90 miles per hour. At impact, the boilers, for reasons unknown, both exploded. Chunks of metal flew from the crash, killing three people and injuring dozens. The remainder of the crowd, after realizing they had survived, climbed up onto the wreck to hunt for souvenirs and have their pictures taken. William Crush was fired on the spot. However, the next day the railroad decided it wasn't really his fault and he was rehired. Was anything learned from this tragedy? Apparently not. Public demonstrations of steam locomotive collisions continued to be done, despite the danger, as this film from the California State Fair in 1914 shows. Fortunately, however, there were no more boiler explosions.
Another poorly designed campaign McDonald's tried to do something on Twitter back in 2012 with the hashtag McDStories campaign, which has suddenly become the longest running hashtag campaign in history. Basically, they kicked things off on a Thursday with the hashtag of hashtag Meet the Farmers, and a campaign meant to draw attention to the brand's guarantee of fresh produce. However, later in the day, the burger company decided to use the dangerously vague hashtag, when you make something with pride, people can taste it. McD potato supplier at hashtag McD stories. People took this hashtag and started talking trash about McDonald's continuously. Within an hour of its appearance as a way to encourage touching McDonald's stories, the company's social media manager could see that the idea had gone terribly wrong. Cheeky tweeters used the campaign to share their grossest and most disturbing experiences, and within 2 hours, the campaign had to be pulled down, but it was too late as the perversely funny string of bad stories had taken on an internal life of its own. A couple of examples include Fingernail in My Big Mash. Once McD stories, McDonald's Twitter hashtag promotion goes horribly wrong. So Pete and McDonald's got into it today on Twitter. I was surprised to know, or didn't know, there was actually meat in McDonald's Mc hashtag story. Ordered a McDouble, something in my damn thing chipped my molar. Hashtag McD stories. Hospitalized for food poisoning after eating McDonald's in 1989. Never ate there again and became a vegetarian. Should have sued. Hashtag McD stories. Hashtag McD stories. I lost 50 pounds in 6 months after I quit working and eating at McDonald's. So basically, with all social media campaigns, always include contingency plans should the conversation not go as planned. The ability to change midstream helped this small blip from becoming a much larger problem. However, the campaign still has gone for a very long time and continues, I think, even still out there now. And this is one of my favorites by Snapple. Basically, an attempt to break the world's Guinness Book of World Record for the world's largest popsicle. Snapple mixed and created a giant popsicle with its kiwi strawberry Snapple on ice flavor. The frozen treat was hauled by a freezer truck from New Jersey all the way to downtown Manhattan, and it was trying to raise it up and vertically with a giant crane. Problem is, it was noon on a hot day in New York on the first day of summer. Snapple tried to answer the question as to whether a 171-foot, 2-ton popsicle can be made to stand upright in Union Square, New York. Well, it can't. So basically what wound up happening was this thing started to melt. Pedestrians were fleeing and not so quite terror. Fire trucks were converging. Police were closing off streets to contain the publicity stunt going wrong. Bikes were riding down the street and skidding out on this stuff, and people were a little bit freaked out when they saw this large amount of pink liquid starting to flow all over East 17th Street. Cars were getting stuck in this thing also. So basically, Snapple officials decided to stop the Snapple raising at the crowd disappointing 25 degree angle. The mushy giant block was then trucked away, and a television-sized ice sculpture in the shape of a Snapple logo took its place. People were basically freaking out by all this pink liquid that was all over the place. One of the cleaning people over at Sephora looked out and saw that there was a lot of pink water pouring all the way down. She noticed that the crane stopped and tried to lift the giant popsicle like a frozen flagpole. They didn't hear it pop. They just saw the pink water flowing down the street. A giant popsicle was being displayed and Snapple was melted in the heat and sun and spilled all the way to 7th Street. Fire departments were on the scene, attempting to wash down the roadway. Sticky goo all over the air is what was reported. Snapple admitted that the idea did not work, and basically that they would never try it again. And a small village in Sweden basically remains to be the Guinness Book World Records winner.
Last September, in the dead of night, the world's most iconic brand did the unthinkable and took an entire country by surprise. 150 of Australia's most popular names appeared on millions of bottles of Coke. Why? Because in the previous month alone, 50% of teens and young adults hadn't even tasted a Coke. We had to reconnect with Australia. So we decided to get personal. The internet blew up straight away, but we kept quiet. And while the buzz grew and grew, we recruited our fans and made them the face of our campaign. Then, on Australia's highest rated media weekend, we came clean and invited Australians all over to share a Coke.
Kate and Kate, the two Kates. Classy Kate. Crazy Kate. If you know a Kate, share a Coke with Kate, or Mel, or Dave, or Jane.
Our message was everywhere, digitally and interactively at Sydney's iconic Coke billboard. Whichever way you turned, it was you and your friends up in lights. The media instantly took notice. Blogs lit up. Australia had fallen in love.
Coca-Cola.
Sharing a Coke.
Thousands of requests poured in for more names, but we were ready. With kiosks where you could get any name printed on a Coke can, people couldn't get enough, queuing for hours. But the requests kept flooding in. So we put it to a vote and asked Australia who they wanted to share a Coke with most. And after 65,000 people got their say, 50 new names were released. We invited everyone to share a Coke, and share they did. Whether old or young, drinkers or non-drinkers, friends searched for names, tagged one another, shared stories. Australians everywhere were once more connecting over the world's most iconic brand. And with the holidays looming, we celebrated and shared a Coke with a friend who brings a smile to every face. In just 3 short months, 5% more people were drinking Coke. Sales transactions grew by 3%. Volume increased by 4%, an 870% increase in Facebook traffic, 12,020,000 earned media impressions, 76,000 virtual Coke cans shared, 378,000 extra Coke cans printed at kiosks, and one country painted red. With one simple tweak to a label, Coke once again became part of popular culture.
IHOP actually created an interesting campaign where they teased that they were going to change their name from IHOP to IHOB, and didn't say what it was originally until right before they decided to announce it, which was that they were going to be selling burgers. And the situation that happened with this was that IHOP was starting to lose a lot of money. They've been seeing traffic declining at the IHOP locations for the past 10 quarters. And people thought about, they've always sold hamburgers at IHOP's. However, most people only saw, during the research, they only saw IHOP as a place to get pancakes and French toast, anything breakfast-wise. So in an effort to try to lure more customers in during their lunchtime, they came up with the IHOP, basically name change, to try to draw people in there. And the campaign seemed to work. Basically, they are now, right after the campaign, they started selling 500,000 burgers per week, which is about 4 times the normal amount of hamburgers that they sold during a regular basis. So basically, they used it to promote a whole new line of hamburgers designed to lure those customers in during that lunchtime time. Now include a number of other videos and examples in the links below. Please feel free to look through them and watch them. Some of them are funny, some of them are very interesting. And it shows how using research, you can achieve a very positive public relations campaign. So as we learned, research is very, very important. And there's different ways you can get research. One is the primary way, by collecting raw data that no one else has yet compiled. Actually interview people, get the information firsthand. Talk to experts, talk to your audiences, talk to your CEOs, talk to your stakeholders who are invested in your company, who make a difference in what you do. The other option that you can do use research with is secondary, basically reading or consulting existing materials that someone else has already compiled. It could be reports, books, the internet, research that's been done by third-party companies, or research that talks about not specifically your company, but whatever it is you do on a more generalized example. And as you already know, if you've taken a journalism class before this one, you're obviously going to know the six almighty questions when you do an interview. Who, what, where, when, why, and also how. So basically, you're trying to get the basic information that you can when you're interviewing somebody to answer these six questions. Who it is that you're trying to talk to, what it is you're trying to accomplish, where is this thing going to take place, when is it going to happen, why are you doing it, and how are you going to go about doing it. Real quick, a couple of interviewing techniques to put out there. Make sure when you're interviewing someone that you do your homework. Get some information ahead of time, so when you or start talking to this person, that you have a good, decent amount of knowledge to ask the right questions. Prepare the interviewees in advance on the interviews. What is different in this situation than a possible reporter journalism story? You want to make sure that the person you're talking to gets a good idea of what you're going to ask them, what they're looking for, so that they can prepare the right responses and information that you need. And basically write down a list of questions that you want answered. Work with from the most general topic to the more specific questions. If you're taping, if you're going to use a recorder, make sure the person's comfortable with it and that you have a good power supply. I had a situation in the past where I was recording an event that was happening. It was a one in a lifetime type of a thing. And in the middle of it, my recorder stopped working. When I played it back, the sound was all screwed up. It was ruined. I couldn't get it back. So make sure you have good battery supply and or it's plugged in or it's charged if you're using your phone. But make sure that the person's aware that you are taping them and is okay with you doing that. And keep space between both of you, free of any distractions or obstructions. Don't put anything in the middle that's going to steer their eyes away. Also, basically, when you're interviewing somebody, break the ice. Small talk with the person, tell a joke, you know, comment on things around their environment that might be interesting. Maybe they have a picture on the wall of something their child drew and talk about that a little bit. So they feel a little bit more relaxed when you do the interview. As the interview progresses, don't be afraid to range freely, like talk about different things, but make sure you get back to your preset questions. Because you don't want the interview to end earlier than you need it to and then not have asked the questions that you really want. If you're unsure about a quote that somebody gave and you think you may have misunderstood it, ask them to repeat or clarify it. Last thing you want to do is make the person you're interviewing upset that you didn't quote them properly or you misstated the words that they used. And finally, be prepared to remember some of the key conversation that takes place after your interview. Sometimes the best stuff comes up when you shut the tape recorder off or you put the paper and pen down and you have just a candid conversation with that person. Try to remember exactly what happened, and when you leave, write down everything that you think you feel would be interesting or important to add to your interview. And as I've mentioned several times about what the definition of public relations is, again, we are trying to establish a positive relationship between an organization and its audiences or its publics. And we're doing that through creating image building techniques. So we're trying to get people to like us, to make sure that the audience that you're trying to reach cares about you or your organization and wants to continue to purchase things or provide money or engage in your services. So how do we do that? What is the public consider an acceptable image? How are you squeaky clean and happy? Well, research can help us kind of figure that out, what the public really thinks of you and what they want to think of you, what they need to know about you, to consider yourself to be likable. Remember, companies need to attract and retain customers. That's the most important goal. We don't always think about the process that a company does to accomplish this, but that's what research is. We try to find out what it is to make sure our customers stay with us and are retained by us. So let's look at the process. What are the types of research that a public relations professional might use to find out this information? How do they get that information to help keep their customers? One type of research that could be used is something called applied research. That's a type of research used to find answers to a specific question or problem. Finding the answer will directly affect our lives and the world around us. So we're taking that research or that information we've learned and applying it to our business or our PR campaign with the hope that it's going to change something. It's going to have an effect on that person in our business at the same time. As you've probably done yourself, doing research on which school offers the best financial aid package is applied research. You're gathering information from different schools about their financial aid packages, and that's going to have a positive benefit to you. The most money we get from a college or a university will help us make a decision whether or not we attend that. And the university or college that offers the best one and gets your business is going to benefit from that also. As I said, knowing the answer to this benefits not only us, but others who are interested in attending the school. Theoretical research, also known as basic research, is centered more on curiosity. Although the information is beneficial to you, it doesn't affect the rest of the world. It's something that your company or your business or whatever just needs to know, or they want to know, to see how they can maybe tweak their models to better attract a customer and keep them. Such as determining how fresh the sandwich is in your refrigerator after 4 days is theoretical research. You're just curious to know. And as we said earlier, one of the most important things that managers want to know is whether or not your research can be measured or shown to be successful. Quantitative research is exactly that. It's research that can be measured accurately. For example, we can accurately measure how many dogs get adopted from shelters each year. They know how many dogs they have, and they know how many have been successfully adopted from people. That's a number we can accurately count. Descriptive data is basically painting a picture of the public you are studying. You're looking for their distinctive demographic characteristics. You build a profile for you to work with, and you're looking at small sample sizes. This is also known as qualitative research. Basically, this is research that's not accurately measured. You're still going to get a good bit of information from doing this, but you're not going to be able to get a specific measurement of it being extremely accurate. It gives you a basis and a start. For example, why did you choose to go to LCC? Now I can ask you, just this class, that question. And I'll usually do this in a live class. However, I'll get numerous different answers. Some people came to LCC for maybe because of the cost. It was lower cost than other schools. Some people come here because it's closer to home and they didn't feel like dorming and they wanted to stay working while they were going to school. Some people like the number of choices that the school offers, or they might particularly enjoy a specific program. If I ask this class, you know, a lot of you are in writing or journalism or English type of a program. So it's not exactly a good indication of everybody at the school who's taken different kind of programs. It's not a large size. There are 11 people here today, and that's not going to give me enough information or enough of a sample size to be able to attribute that to a larger audience. But it gives me some ideas. If I learn from this group that maybe you like the low cost and the number of programs that we have to offer, I can then use that information when I'm doing a survey of a larger group of what kind of questions I need to ask, or it gives me a sense of what I think might wind up being the answer. Qualitative research, which would be the next step then, allows me to generalize about a larger population. I sample a public that must be entirely representative of the larger group that we're trying to reach. I'm using random sampling, and everyone in the group has an equal chance of being picked. So basically, I'm getting a better idea of a larger population. When you see these surveys that are done about polls that go on, they're trying to get a certain amount of people that they can then attribute to a larger audience. Using random sampling and using, you're not picking a specific demographic that will skewer those results. So basically, we're trying to get an idea by asking fairly good sized group of people and then being able to attribute that to a larger group of people. So the difference between the two, basically, quantitative research relies on true random samples. So you need to have at least 400 people to be valid statistically. Researchers must formulate questions in advance. Results can be generalized then to a larger population, and decisions are based on statistical analysis. Qualitative research relies on in-depth examination of individual respondents, so they're asking more in-depth questions. Sample sizes are a lot smaller usually. Decisions are not always based on statistical analysis, and it provides a good starting point for subsequent qualitative research. So it gives you the basis for what it is you're trying to do. So the different kind of things are phone calls or phone polls versus focus groups, mail surveys versus in-depth interviews, mail intercept studies or mall intercept studies where you're actually talking to different people as you see them walking down the stores, or just watching them through participation observation. You can have face-to-face interviews versus non-participant observation. You can share cost studies or use message testing. Or you can use panel studies versus oral histories. Laboratory experience versus polling. Telephone polling is usually the most effective for external communication. You get a very high rate of returns, low cost, cheaper than trying to mail people over and over again. You get faster results because you're getting the results immediately, and there's less of a bias because you're not seeing that person face to face. Mail questionnaires are effective for internal communication. They're fairly fast, they're cheap, and you don't get that bias also because you're not seeing the person you're interviewing. So where do you find information, especially with secondary research? You can find it inside the organization. Usually this information is kept by your research people or, you know, statistics or figures that we have. Government agencies or documents, that's always out there. Associations and networks. I get a lot of information just by talking to groups. I'm on listservs of other schools and colleges and universities, and I get a lot of ideas and information from what other people are doing or seeing. Your clients or your customers. Ask your customers what they're the best source of information. Do surveys with that group. Just listen to the media, what's going on out there in the world. References, journals that are out there, libraries, databases, the internet has a lot of information, obviously. Using interviews, doing surveys, focus groups of people, sampling, just watching, experience, observation. You know, sometimes people can figure out how to best put sidewalks in based on where people walk on their institution. Conferences or workshops are great for gathering information. You're hearing from experts and also your peers. And also your sales records, your memberships, your contributions. See where the money's coming from. See how well sales are after you do a campaign. And of course, social media is one of the biggest ways to get immediate feedback or information. You can ask people and get an immediate response right away. So there's two ways that we can get information about who our audiences are. One is demographics. We can identify the size of the population's capacity to expand or decline by including certain characteristics of the audience for any medium, such as gender, age, family, education, income, religion, economics. And we get a lot of this information from the census, from statistics that the local governments can provide. So we kind of know in our area general statistics or information. We get an idea of, you know, how old people are, how many males versus females there are in the area. We can know what family sizes there are and what education backgrounds they come from. So a lot of this information is readily available out there because we're asking people, the government's asking people, and we can obtain that information quickly. And a lot of people collect this information and use it and sell it to other people. Another attribute we can get is psychographics, which is the attitudes and images held by media audiences. This reveals personality traits and lifestyles of an audience member. And before the internet, basically a lot of information that the business and industry had about you came from different things you did. If you, you know, sometimes where you shopped based on credit card information, what magazines you ordered, what memberships you took at different places, and whatever the census provided. That was, you know, they had a certain amount of points that they got from you, points of information that they obtained. Nowadays, with the internet and with your wonderful little cell phone, business and industry can track thousands of things about you that it can then use to provide information and target specific campaigns at you that you didn't even realize. There are things out there called cookies. So when you go on a website, little snippets of information is dropped into your browser so they can follow where you go and see what websites you visit, what interests you have. They can track everything you do on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, all collect all the information that you have out there, who your friends are, what things you like or dislike. Places you visited, you're telling people where you are at any given moment. I can buy a list, and I do this all the time, that can basically track a lot of information about you. I can geofence your house. I can basically put a information to your specific address. I can check where you've gone. If you like to go to, let's say, I'm trying to promote our automotive program, and there's a auto show at the Hanover High School parking lot. Well, I can actually use the internet and put a geofence around that particular parking lot at the day and time of that event. I can actually drop ads on your phone and cookies on your phone so that it will follow you when you leave there, and I can put ads on your phone of our automotive program based on where you were and what event you went to. Not only that, the second you walk in your door and you connect to your Wi-Fi, that information is then sent to your computers, your iPads, even now with your smart TV, is then can be used to send specific ads to your household. That's the way it works now. When you walk down the street, and you have a location tracker on your phone, I can tell if you're coming near my business, and I can hit you with ads for a 2-for-1 drink special, knowing that you're on the street that I'm on and you're in a very close proximity. That's the scary part about getting your information out there. All that information is packaged and sold to business and industries all over to target you with specific ads and with specific messages to try to influence you to do something. And once I figured out who you are and what your demographic or psychographic is, and I'm trying to reach you through various media, I have to figure out what audience I'm trying to reach, what media outlets that person uses, and what's the credibility of that media. Is it something that people are going to believe when they see or hear something on it? And when you do reach this kind of an audience, what is your message that's going to be put out there that's going to be the most effective? And how much do I need to spend to reach your intended audience, and how much can you actually afford? Yes, I'd love to be able to reach a lot of millions and millions of people, but it might cost me a lot of money to do that. So if I can pick specific audiences that I want to reach, that I know will buy my product, will send me money for a charity, or will attend my church service, I can save a lot of money by picking that specific audience and targeting that specific audience. For example, if I'm trying to, besides trying to reach people on the internet or through social media specifically, say I want to reach a specific audience through a radio station. Well, there are plenty of radio stations out there in the Wilkes-Barre market, and I can target each of these for the audience that I'm trying to reach. If I'm trying to reach an older audience, I can use WVIA or I can use WILK. Both are ones a talk radio show that reaches a specific type, an older, mostly male audience. And the other one, WVIA, also attracts a little bit of an older audience. So if I want to reach that demographic, those are the radio stations I would go to. If I want to try to get a younger audience, I can go with a 97.1, which is more of a pop radio station, or KRZ, which is also more of a pop radio station. They're a slightly younger, slightly more female type of an audience. If I want an older male audience specifically, I might go with Rock 107, which plays classic rock. 95.3 just switched to an all Spanish format, so it's all Hispanic music that's playing on there. If I want to reach that particular audience, that's the radio station I would also promote on. And 92.1 switched from alternative to 90s till now, so that reaches a specific age group that I might want to also target, especially if I'm looking for parents of high school graduates who I want to make sure I get my message out to. So there are many different stations, and either radio stations, whether they be television stations, whether they be newspapers, whether they be specific websites or specific social media. And we'll talk really heavy about social media down the line. But Facebook tends to be now skewing to more of an older audience, whereas Instagram, Snapchat, and TikTok, are going to more younger audiences. So when I'm trying to craft the message, I need to make sure who my audience is, and what kind of messages that audience wants to hear. What kind of pictures, what kind of video do I want to show on each of those different formats will be way different based on who it is we're trying to reach. That's the end of our research lecture for this week. And now I hope this gives you a rough understanding of why research is important in public relations and how it can be used to, again, develop your public relations campaign and make sure you get the most out of the messages that you put out there. It can lead to great things or it can lead to disaster if you don't do it correctly. Feel free to check out some of the examples that I place on the links below. And check out today's assignment. Basically, we're going to learn how to be nurses. So this is part of something that we're going to talk about next week. But the reality is, PR people, you and I are experts at a lot of great things, but we're not experts at everything. I work at a college where we have 100 different majors, ranging from automotive to engineering design to architecture to nursing to science and biology. I might know a little bit about all of that, but I don't know all of it. So basically, I have to do a lot of research when I need to talk about or promote any one of those things. And one of the things I wanted to do today, I don't know if anybody's a nurse in our class or not, or have had any experience doing that, but we're going to talk about a potential PR event in the next class. And it's going to involve something to do with the healthcare industry, specifically nursing field. So I have you looking up a number of different questions about nursing. So see what you can come up with for those questions. And then we're going to use those answers in our promotion for our next class. Good luck. If you have any questions, again, please contact me or reach out to me, or if you have any other suggestions for one of our future classes. Thank you.